We are in Romans chapter 3 today. We're searching for the truths of Christian doctrine that Paul wrote to the church in Rome, and that's where we're going. So Romans chapter 3, and I want to begin by saying that Paul takes this entire chapter to show that religion doesn't remedy the problem. In fact, in many ways, it makes the problem worse that we have. Many people today, they just believe that following some religion, following this religion, is going to be what they need to be in a right relationship with God. And we know that's not true. In fact, this is a fatal mistake. And Paul proves that it is and points it out in this particular chapter. So he begins by establishing in verse 1 and 2 the faithfulness of God. It says there, what advantage then is there in being a Jew, or what value is there in circumcision? Paul is asking this rhetorical question, but he answers, he says, much in every way. First of all, the Jews have been entrusted with the very words of God. What advantage is there for being a Jew? I'm telling you, the Jews have been blessed, and God handed them the gospel. He handed them the gospel. Now, we know that they, as a nation, rejected the Messiah. But many, many Jews have received Jesus Christ as the Messiah today. We call them Messianic Jews, I guess, for any different term. But many of Jews are turning to Christ. Many Muslims are turning to Christ. And so there is a great harvest going on. And our prayers are helping expand that great harvest. Great revival that's taken place around the world. We were talking earlier, someone mentioned that, you know, the church grows under persecution. And I look around in America and I see the church kind of blah, 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 blah. Church attendance is going down in everywhere, every denomination. You see church attendance, there are a few spikes here and there that you read about or hear about in the media. But for all intention, church attendance is going down. And that's a shame. But you know where people are being persecuted for their faith? In Africa, in the Sudan, and in Islamic countries, and even now some places in America, where people are being persecuted for their faith is flourishing and the church is flourishing. And sometimes I wonder, should we not be praying for persecution? Because it would build our faith and it would grow the body of Christ. But something inside of me says, no, we're not praying for persecution. We don't want to do that. But I'll tell you what we do need to do. We need to get serious about our faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. And about the mission that He has entrusted to us with the gospel. What advantage is there in being a Jew? What advantage is there in being a Gentile that received Christ? We have the gospel and we can share it. In verse 3 and 4 it says, what if some were unfaithful? Will their unfaithfulness nullify God's faithfulness? Not at all. Let God be true and every human being be a liar. God is faithful in spite of our unfaithfulness. Now I'm going to tell you that I think the church today, for the most part I'm talking about, there are some powerful, strong Christians. But for the church, as a most part in America, is a wimp. Do you hear me? I believe it's a wimp. I believe that for most Christian congregations, they sashay in, they do church, and they sashay out, and they go about their lives, and then next Sunday, if it's convenient, they come to church again, and then they go back out again. Listen, God is not pleased with that. And God will bring persecution on the church in America to get us revived and get us back headed in the right direction. But I believe we can bypass that persecution if we will get on board now while things are good. You know, during Hurricane Katrina, it was a Cat 5 and went right up through where we lived in Mississippi. I know at least 1,500 people initially lost their lives. They had 8 refrigeration trucks, 18-wheelers in there with bodies where they just kept stacking the bodies. And they kept bringing in refrigeration trucks. And it was sad. But the people started flocking into the churches. And the church pews got full. And people started showing up and like, wow, this is really cool. God, look, you're reviving the church. And then as the months started going on and people started to get back in their houses and things got back to normal, guess what happened? Church attendance just kind of fell back where it was. In fact, it was lower in many cases. In the church we were in, we were running like 160 on Sunday mornings before Katrina. And after that, we went down to 60 and then went to 30 and then maybe back up to 50. And then it kind of leveled off there. And so less people are going to church today, I believe, than when it was before the disaster. When this hurricane comes through and it affects so many people's lives, I believe people will be turning to God and crying out to God. And then when things get better, they kind of put God on the back burner. We don't need you now. God, to many people, is a genie in the bottle. When things go bad, you need something, call on God. Well, I'm telling you, God is not that kind of God. But He is faithful even in our unfaithfulness.
Amen.
He never changes. Our unfaithfulness does not affect God being faithful to us. And that may sound illogical, but God's nature and He promises, they don't change because of our performance, how we act. While we understand that God's faithfulness is not based on how we act or our performance, Paul says that no one is righteous. He concludes the first 8 verses by asking this question in verse 9. Do we have any advantage? Not at all. For we have already charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. Because in verse 10 it says, it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. Not even one. Not me, not you, not one is righteous. The righteousness that we have as believers, Paul gives a very good explanation for that. He says, we put on, can you imagine putting on a jacket? We put on the righteousness of Christ. The only righteousness that we have is that in Christ. When people look at you, I pray they don't see you. They see a reflection of the righteousness of God in your life.
Amen.
But for them to see that, for the world to see that, we have to live that Christian life. We cannot be sold out to Jesus on Sunday and just sold out to the world on Monday. We can't do that. Can't live like that. Can't sit on a fence with Jesus. It reminds me of some of the fences I saw overseas. And they have like a brick wall. You know, it's got a wall and it'll be plastered and all. And then right on top of it, they put some wet cement right there, and then they stick broken glass in it or barbed wire in it. You can't sit on that fence. And God doesn't want you on the fence. We got to make a decision that it's going to be about Jesus 24/7. And then he goes on in verse where he says, there is no righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. Do you realize when you got saved, you weren't seeking God? God came after you. He sought you out. You weren't looking for Him. He sought you out. He came to you. I love that song. Now I'm trying to remember the name of it. He came to me, I think it's a song. Yeah, He came to me. There was a really tough time in our lives, Diane and I, and that song came over the radio. And I heard it. I was just driving back from Hattiesburg to Richmond one day, and that song came on the radio, and God just spoke to me. And God just said, I'm coming to you in your time of need. In your time when you need me most, I'm there, and I'm coming to you. And then Paul references in verse 12, the reference several psalms, he makes the point. He refers to these here in the New Testament. He refers to these psalms. He says in verse 12, all have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. And this is from Psalm 14, and it's also found in Psalm 53. So Paul knows that his audience recognizes these psalms, and so he's quoting them. Verse 13, it says, their throats are open graves, their tongues practice deceit. That comes from Psalms 5:9. And then their poison The poison of vipers is in their lips, Psalm 140, verse 3. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways, and the way of peace they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes. And he quotes Psalm 36, verse 1. So as our argument brings us to the truth, our third point, that righteousness comes through faith. That's it. Here lies the guts of the gospel. Righteousness comes through faith. Amen. There are two aspects of divine righteousness I want to remind you about. First of all, we have a saving righteousness, saves us. And then there is a judgment, a judging righteousness of God. Paul already dealt with the judging righteousness by demonstrating that even attempting to obey the law, listen closely, even attempting to obey the law brings about divine wrath and spiritual exile. We know that. You can't try to get to God by being good. Hello.
That's right.
You can't do that. That doesn't work. Because you're not good enough. None of us are. So Paul already addresses that. Now he addresses God's saving righteousness. It has been manifested in the death of Jesus Christ, and it is received by faith alone in the finished work, what Jesus did on Calvary some 2,000 years ago. You know, as he hung there on that cross, he died for your sin. Someone said, well, you know, I accepted Jesus and I know he paid for all that sin, but what about my future sin? Well, all of your sin was future when Jesus died on that cross. He paid for every bit of it, past, present, future, however you want to look at it. At the cross, God's judging righteousness and saving righteousness came together and were reconciled. You say, how can that be so? How can it be reconciled, saving righteousness and judging? Because God is just in his judging. Amen?
Amen.
He is going to judge sin. And he judged your sin on Calvary. When you gave your life to Christ, that shed blood of Jesus covered you. It kind of gives us the picture of atonement, of going back to the Old Testament and the tabernacle. When once a year the high priest would come out and he would take that blood and he would put it on the scapegoat. You know what a scapegoat is, right? It's one that takes it for you. And so they would take the scapegoat after they put the blood on it and sprinkled it on the sacrifice, and they'd send that scapegoat away. And that gives us a picture, not quite effective, but it gives us a picture of your sins are gone as far as the east is from the west.
Amen.
And they would shoo that scapegoat out in the desert. They didn't want him to come back. They didn't want him to bring their sin penalty back. And when Christ died on the cross, he took the penalty of your sin. He paid for it on the cross. And I love what the Bible says, that he went into death and hell, and he took those keys. Satan didn't give them up. I know there was a fight there, and I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall when Jesus took the keys from Satan of death and hell. And the Bible says that death doesn't have a sting anymore. There's no effect of death. There's no sting. When you draw your last breath, Diane's mama the other day drew her last breath and was in glory immediately. Amen. Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. And so when we draw that last breath, our spirit, our soul leaves. And I know, and I'm going to tell you, I believe this. I'm laying there dead. And my spirit and soul start coming out of my body, and there's a couple of angels grab me by each arm, and they usher me right into the presence of Almighty God. And there's Jesus and God the Father and the Holy Spirit. The whole kabang is right there, and I am immediately in His presence. Can I get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
We seem to dread death, and I don't like pain now, I'm going to tell you. I don't like pain and suffering. But death doesn't offend me. It doesn't scare me. It doesn't rile me at all. Because when I draw that last breath, I am at the beginning of eternal life. Amen?
Yes.
Wow, where did I go with that? Amen. Hallelujah. Okay. And so look at verse 21. But now, it says, apart from the law, the righteousness of God had been made known, to which the law and the prophets testified. You know, these words provide a glorious transition from the judgment of verse 20 to the justification of verse 21. But now, these words, but now, speaks of the newness of God's work in Christ. Things have changed. Where the Old Testament had to keep offering these sacrifices, they did it at morning, noon, and night. They did the evening sacrifices. They sent scapegoats out. Listen, God says, but now I have brought it all together. I have finished it in Christ. It's a new covenant. We are being witnessed by the law and the prophets that reminds us that there is still a connection to God's work today to what the prophecies of the Old Testament were. Paul previously told us where righteousness does not come from. He said it doesn't come from the works that you do. Righteousness does not come from the works. But now he steps in a bit further and he said, now I'm going to tell you where it does come from. It comes from your faith in Jesus Christ and in Him alone. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
From Him alone. Verse 22 says, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. What are they believing? They're believing that Jesus died for your sins, that He took on that penalty of sin, that He was buried and on the third day rose again and ascended to the Father, and now He sits at the right hand of God, the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us, the saints, as we go through our daily lives trying to live for Jesus and doing our best to do it. He's interceding for us. Where the devil comes and tries to tempt us, Jesus Himself is interceding for us. I love the picture in the book of Acts where they took Stephen out and they were going to stone Stephen because of his faith in Jesus. And they said, that's blasphemy. And they were going to take him out and stone him. And the picture that we have is of Jesus stands up off from his throne and looks upon Stephen as he is being the first martyr recorded in the New Testament. I believe when you get into a bind, Jesus raises up and he looks closely because he's paying attention to what's going on in each of our lives. He sees the hurt, the pain, the agony, the suffering. But he also sees those times when we're in here praising him and giving him praise and glory. Throughout my life, I look back over the last, especially in ministry, last 33 years, and I see God's hand delivering me from the clutches of the world. I see God's hand delivering us just this week from a terrible hurricane. I hate that anybody had to suffer through it, but we are a blessed people here this morning. There are tens of thousands, if not millions of people in this country right now who don't have lights on, who don't have air conditioning, who don't have water running that they can get a drink from, cannot go back into their church because the roof's gone now. Amen? And we are a blessed people. So it goes on in here again he reiterates that there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek in verse 23. He says, for all, say that with me, all, I can't hear you,
all,
that's everybody, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came through Christ Jesus. So he develops the doctrine of salvation around three things that I want to share with you real quick. First of all, the theme of justification. Justification is an image from the court of law. It's freely given by the judge. And it solves the problem of man's guilt before a righteous judge. So justification is when we approach the throne and we are to be judged, and the judge looks on you and he can't really see you. He can't see your sin because you're covered by the blood of Christ. His shed blood. Now, a lot of people don't want to talk about the blood. Say, that's not kosher. That's not really culturally correct. Well, get over it. I don't care. The Bible talks about the blood because the life is in the blood, and the blood shed on Calvary saves us from a devil's hell when we put our faith in the finished work of what Jesus Christ has done. So that's justification. And then the second word is redemption. It's an image that someone is being gone to the slave market and being bid on and purchased off the slave block. That was you and me. We were redeemed by Christ by the blood of the Lamb, the Bible says. I love that term in Revelation. It has the idea of being bought back. We were once lost. He didn't own us, and He bought us back with His shed blood. And it solves the problem of man's slavery to sin. The world and the devil. We are no longer in bondage. I want to bring a point out that bothers me. I hope it upsets you too. And the fact is that when we sin, we did not have to sin. You hearing me? We do not have to sin any longer being in Christ. We still live in the cart and we're still tempted and we still do give in to sinful desires sometimes. But we don't have to. So I want you to recognize that you can't say, well, the devil's sitting over here and he made me do it. Like Flip Wilson said, the devil made me do it. No. The Bible says that where temptation comes, Jesus, God has made a way of escape. So no matter what temptation comes to you, there is a way of escape. Now sometimes I pick up my Bible and I start reading Scripture. But you know what we can do? The implication here, the idea is, when temptation comes to you, turn the other way and run. Amen. Run! You don't have to stay around and entertain it, because it all takes place up here, doesn't it? Temptation comes here, and if you entertain the thought, you have crossed the line. But you can hear that thought, and you can say, no, I'm not going there. And I do this regularly. Things come to my mind, and I say, I'm not going there. Hallelujah. God gives us a way of escape. And then the third thing after justification and redemption is propitiation. I'm glad I was able to say that without stumbling on it. Propitiation. It's an image from the world of religion of appeasing a God through sacrifice. And it means the turning away of wrath by an offering to God. For the Christian, the propitiation was the shed blood of Jesus on the cross. That is, He is our propitiation. He is what turns away the wrath of God coming on us. And where some people say and believe that in the book of Revelation that Christians will suffer through part of the wrath of God, I don't believe that. I don't believe it because it says we are not subject to God's wrath. He will not pour His wrath on us because He poured it out on Jesus and we accept Him.
Amen.
Propitiation. It means turning away God's wrath. It turned away the wrath of God so He could pass over the sins previously committed. In fact, all of our sins. I know I shouldn't use the word previous because it is past, present, and future sins. It was the Father who sent the Son to be the propitiation for all. And propitiation solves the problem of offerings to the Creator. Because we don't have to try to offer something to God to get our salvation. That works. And in verse 25, we find the guts of the gospel. Listen, verse 25. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement, that is, a propitiation in the King James, through the shedding of His blood, to be received by what? Faith. To be received by faith. The King James translates this sacrifice as propitiation. The Living Bible says, it says it this way, to take the punishment for our sins. That means to turn God's wrath away from us and on to Christ Jesus as that sacrifice for our sin. The point is that we understand that the covering of our sins happens by faith in Christ's shed blood at Calvary. It is His blood that covers your sin. The final verses in the chapter tell us why He did this. I think this was really interesting. Verse I can't remember what number it is. 25. Yeah, we're still in 25. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness. He did this propitiation to demonstrate his righteousness because in his forbearance, he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. There was a time when he wasn't punishing people's sins. But now at Calvary, that punishment came to bear on Jesus. He says he did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Now, God demonstrates his righteousness by offering man justification. It's a legal verdict saying that we're not guilty now. Justification. While remaining completely just, because God is just, that means because the righteous penalty of sin had been paid for on the cross. So do you see what's happening here? There's a process going on. The sins of mankind had not been paid for, had not been dealt with, and God said in times past, I've let it slide for a little while. I've let it slide. But now I've offered my Son as a propitiation, a sacrifice, an atonement for your sin, and now I'm holding you account. Now I'm holding you account for your sin. You can either pay your own sin debt and go to hell, or you can allow and accept Jesus' payment on the cross by faith. Put your faith in what he's done and let his propitiation, the wrath of God, come on him and not on you and I. It came on him. He said, I gladly bore it. I took it on, the sins of the world. And when you put your faith in what he's already done, listen, that wrath of God doesn't come on us. Doesn't come on us now. It doesn't come on us in the book of Revelation. Because Jesus has taken the wrath of God. So in conclusion, I want to say that ultimately we were created for God's good pleasure. God created mankind because he wanted to love mankind. And he wanted to receive mankind's love and worship and honor and glory. Part of that includes being the recipient of his grace, demonstrated, the Bible says, by his righteousness. God has demonstrated how much he loves us by covering our sins with the sacrificial blood of his own Son. It's only through Jesus that we have redemption through his blood and can have eternal life with God. Would you stand with me as we pray?